developed over the years is to navigate through chronic illness with a mindset of chronic wellness. So what I've come to understand and appreciate is the importance of self-care. And when I talk about self-care, I don't mean things like going to the spa and having afternoon naps, although those are amazing. When I talk about self-care these days, it's addressing the areas of daily living that help support overall wellness, such as getting a good night's sleep, paying attention to nutrition and hydration, getting regular exercise, moving our bodies, and managing stress. Self-care and self-management, however, is only part of the equation. While I'm someone who spends an awful lot of time talking about natural health and wellness modalities, it would not be a complete picture if I did not include the fact that so much of the mobility and function that I have today is due to well-managed care received from my rheumatologists over the past four decades. Joining me in studio today is Dr. Allison Kidd. Dr. Kidd is the current chair of the Medical Advisory Committee of the Arthritis Society of BC. She holds an MD and PhD through the University of Calgary, focusing on arthritis research, and has postgraduate training in internal medicine from the University of Alberta, and completed her fellowship in rheumatology at UBC and the University of Sydney in Australia. She's a rheumatologist at St. Paul's Hospital and has her primary practice here in Nanaimo, BC. Welcome to the show, and welcome to Chronic Wellness.
Thank you for having me, Sandra. It's exciting to be here.
Thank you so much. So, with September being Arthritis Awareness Month, arthritis is something that affects so many people. But there may be a bit of a misunderstanding of actually what arthritis is. Can you tell our listeners just briefly how would you describe the actual process of arthritis?
Yeah, arthritis is fascinating. It does affect so many people. I think the numbers I have is on the Vancouver Island itself, it's probably 150,000 people have some type of arthritis.
Wow.
So that's one in five people. But I think what's really confusing for people is that arthritis means many things to different people, mm-hmm. and there's different types of arthritis. There's actually over 100 types of arthritis, and I think sometimes that's why people get a bit confused as to what their treatment is and why it's different than someone who's their friend who has a different treatment and so forth. So when I'm thinking about arthritis, I usually divide it up into sort of two or three groups. There's your more common type, which is called osteoarthritis, mm-hmm. and that can affect your knees, for example, and your hips, and sometimes in your back, and people sometimes get knee replacements or hip replacements. You can also have it in your hands. But then there's also many other types of arthritis which are completely different, and those are what we call inflammatory arthritises. And the most mm-hmm. common of those is rheumatoid arthritis. So a lot of people, when they notice that they have pain and maybe some swelling in the joint, they always worry that it might be something like rheumatoid arthritis. But trying to figure out which condition you have is actually the crux of what I do. Mm-hmm. Or at least part of what I do, and then trying to treat them. But just making sure you have the right diagnosis so that you can know what to do going forward, because the treatments are quite different.
Mm-hmm, yeah, for sure. Mm-hmm. And aside from osteoarthritis, that's the most common one, and it usually comes along as a result of aging. A lot of people get that in, mm-hmm. sort of like the wear and tear of joints.
Absolutely. So it's more common as you get older, but some people, just because of their genetics, or you know, maybe they injured their knee when they were younger, and that knee got prone to having arthritis. There's different reasons to get it, but people can develop it at any stage, usually after your 40s, maybe mm-hmm. later on, and it gets more and more common as you get older. And when people have osteoarthritis, they often, I'll use the knee as an example, they often might have an achy knee, and it's particularly painful when they, you know, get out of a long, sitting in the car for a long time, or when they get out of bed in the morning, and it mm-hmm. might look like it's getting bigger, and it feels kind of hard and a bit swollen, and it sort of crunches or cracks when they move it around. That would sort of be arthritis of the knee, and that's the osteoarthritis type. So wear and tear is a good way to think about it. Some people don't like thinking of it that way, but mm-hmm. really that's sort of practically what's happening. The body's joints are amazing. For most of them, they last your entire lifetime, but it's a lot of pressure that we put on our knees, and the more pressure, the more wear and tear we get.
Mm-hmm. And this is something where things like, if you're having a higher body weight, that's going to make it more challenging, for instance, if you have osteoarthritis of your knees, just because, again, it's that extra weight.
Yeah, it's true. It's really interesting. When they've studied weight loss and arthritis, they've shown that even a very small weight change 10 pounds, say, can actually cause dramatic improvement in your knee symptoms. So whenever doctors are talking to patients, or if patients are even thinking themselves about weight loss, I think people often set themselves an expectation of, you know, I'm going to aim for the weight I was when I was 20, or, you know, some unrealistic goal. But if you want to make your, for example, knee or hip feel better, just a 10-pound weight loss can be mm-hmm. fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So aside from osteoarthritis, many of the other forms are more of an inflammatory arthritis, and they affect more than just the joints, correct?
Absolutely. And that's what I'm always trying to explain to people. So using rheumatoid as an example, just because it's the most common type, rheumatoid arthritis is a condition that causes inflammation in the joints. So they get swollen and warm. They're really stiff for hours in the morning, and then they loosen up as the day goes on. But although we see it mostly in the joints, it's actually a whole body condition. So some people can get nodules, which are lumps under the skin. Some people can get lung irritation. We know that people who have that type of arthritis are more likely to have heart attacks and strokes if their mm-hmm. inflammation is uncontrolled. And so it really is a whole body picture.
One of the things that I know for myself personally, and from speaking to other people with rheumatoid arthritis, is that especially when we're in an active flare, the fatigue is mm-hmm. sometimes such a huge impact. Is that due to, because all the other stuff that's coursing through our body?
Yeah, absolutely. So when your body is inflamed, it's almost like having the flu. You feel tired, you're fatigued, and so that can often go, I mean, everyone's experience is different, but that can definitely go along with a flare. And so it's surprising to people how much that can affect them. Sometimes it take, you know, they think it's something else that's causing it, but really it's just that inflammation. And usually when you get the inflammation under control, the fatigue comes into line two, which mm-hmm. is really helpful for people. They like that.
Yes, yes, mm-hmm. they do. So one of the stats that I was reading in preparing for the show is that arthritis is one of the leading causes of disability. So what are some of the symptoms or challenges that people that are experiencing arthritis at a level that they become having to take a disability?
Absolutely. So I think it's on many fronts, and it depends in a way on what kind of arthritis you have. So for example, a young person who gets rheumatoid arthritis, you know, if their arthritis isn't well controlled, perhaps their hands don't work well, and maybe they're exhausted and they have trouble continuing with their normal work, let alone chasing after small children or whatever mm-hmm. else they have going on in their life. So it can cause trouble with the function of your body, so your joints, but also the energy level. And it's also difficult, especially when you're starting treatment, you have to go for appointments, mm-hmm. you have to get blood work done, for example, and that really can cause difficulties initially for people to try and keep working. We definitely know that people who are able to keep working and do better in the long run. And now that we have better treatments available to us, we're finding that many more people are able to continue with work, which is good for them and good for everyone, and they get a lot of benefit from that.
Absolutely. And I think as well that being aware that sometimes the small things can make such a difference, and mm-hmm. looking at asking for or creating some accommodations in the workplace can make things a lot easier, even as simple as ergonomics for sitting correctly, having mm-hmm. the right keyboard height, having a stool under your desk mm-hmm. so that you can make things a little bit easier. And I think one of the things that's sometimes challenging for employees to feel comfortable enough to want to even bring that up.
Yeah, absolutely. And I've heard from people that what they really find benefit from is some of the support groups. I know the Arthritis Society and the Mary Pack Society, they have some resources for people. They have occupational therapists. Even just talking to someone else who has gone through a similar process with their employer, saying what information do you want to share? What information mm-hmm. do you not want to share? What are the ideas that can make it functional? So instead of going in and saying, I'm having all these issues, come in with solutions and say, you know, my occupational therapist said that if I adjust my chair and maybe if I have my keyboard change, mm-hmm. you know, having really concrete things to work on. And I also think that with the jobs changing as they are nowadays, with people working from home and more flexibility, I'm hoping that that also helps for people, because I think work in general is hopefully getting a little bit more flexible that way.
That's right. Yeah, there are some changes with that way. One of the things that I always would find really hard to plan around is sometimes the unpredictability of changes from one day to the next. Mm-hmm. And it can be really dramatic. Why is the body jumping around like that so much?
Yeah, the immune system is amazing. I mean, the immune system starts developing from the day you're born, and it learns to react to all of these things, but it's always changing. And so arthritis has these flare-ups, and that's the immune system sort of going through ups and downs, or little hills and valleys, and how it's acting. And they can be unpredictable. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they are a little more predictable. You know, if you're stressed or if you've been ill, sometimes that can cause a flare, or if you've had to miss your medications, for example. But that can be hard to manage. And I think once you have a relation, you know, if you are being on treatment and you're following with a physician or another practitioner, having techniques to use for those times, whatever it is that helps you get through those periods of time when it is in a flare, be it medications or other techniques that work for you, I think that is always a good idea.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned before about support groups and resources, mm-hmm. and the Arthritis Society and the Mary Pack mm-hmm. one, which is over in the Lower Mainland, mm-hmm. over in Vancouver. That's actually where I started my very first treatment when I was diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis when I was 8 years old. Mm-hmm. And in that time, it was that was treatment, of course, have changed, and we'll talk about that a little bit later on. But the simple fact of I was getting my physiotherapy there, mm-hmm. and all of a sudden I was interacting and connecting with other individuals mm-hmm. that were just like me, mm-hmm. that were experiencing the same sorts of things. And then there would be other things like education and pamphlets, and then there's workshops that you can take for mm-hmm. self-management mm-hmm. and things like that. And it can getting sometimes being diagnosed with a condition or a disease that affects your mobility or things like that, it can be a little alarming. You don't mm-hmm. know where to go. There mm-hmm. can be so much. So having resources, mm-hmm. I think, is really amazing. And of course, things have changed so much now with we've got the internet and mm-hmm. and all of that. But I really encourage people to connect with resources and with community, because mm-hmm. it can be a lot that can be learned there. And just like you said, you know, how did you present this with your employer, and mm-hmm. what sort of stuff that did you talk about? I think that's really, really powerful.
I agree. And I think we're lucky to be in British Columbia, because BC has been on the leading front of arthritis treatment for a very, very long time. And because of that, there's actually quite a few resources that people may not even know about. So the Mary Pack is in Vancouver, yep. and that's a place where people, like you said, can go for education and physiotherapy, occupational therapy. They also have an office in Victoria, so people can access the same resources. And then with the change in technology, a lot of the groups are actually improving their online access. So the Arthritis Society website is fantastic. Mm-hmm. There's even a collaborative group called Arthritis BC and Me, which has taken all of the different groups that are interested in arthritis, so the physicians, the patients, the Arthritis Society, and put them all together onto one website so that people can try and access that information. And there's a lot of online webinars now. You know, if you can't make it to a talk, for example, of the Arthritis Society, often there's an online version that you mm-hmm. can access, or there's, you know, there's just so many ways to access that information. And I think it's empowering to people. It's also really nice to meet other people who have a similar condition, just to, you know, just like everything else, to you see what their experience has yep. been like, and talk to other people. And I encourage people to reach out if they feel like it to those groups, because that can be such a empowering resource.
The Arthritis Society is also helpful to patients for things like orthotics and splints mm-hmm. and stuff like that. Over the course of time, I've taken advantage of getting, you know, the customized splints for when mm-hmm. I was doing handwriting and for orthotics and things like that. Someone on my Facebook page yesterday mentioned that there used to be an Arthritis Society in Nanaimo.
Mm-hmm.
And
think the office is in Victoria now. They've consolidated there. But they come up island and they do talks. I gave a talk a few weeks ago for the Arthritis Society. And we do have some of those resources here in Nanaimo mm-hmm. as well. And we're always trying to encourage more. We have, for example, a great hand therapist. And then there's good physiotherapists here in Nanaimo as well. But we definitely use that Victoria resource quite often.
Mm-hmm, for sure. So I'd mentioned that my diagnosis was in the 1970s. And that was, it was actually when I first was diagnosed at my GP, they didn't quite know what was going on with me. But then it was determined that it was, I guess at that time, a juvenile rheumatoid arthritis. And the treatment has come leaps and bounds over the course of years. So, you know, early, let's talk first about the importance of early diagnosis.
Absolutely. So when we're treating inflammatory arthritises, so not the osteoarthritis, but all of those other inflammatory ones, we used to be very slow about our treatments. We used to try one thing, give it a try for a couple of years, say it wasn't working, try something else. But in the 90s, we started to realize that if we could control arthritis and treat it like you're putting out a fire, if you could get it under control and stop it from damaging the joints, then people don't end up with the long-term problems that can come from the uncontrolled arthritis. So we really emphasize the importance of early treatment, so early diagnosis and treatment, to try and get that condition under control, because people do so much better now. And to top that off, we have better treatments nowadays that are available, so that, you know, we used to only have a few options for people, and now we have almost too many options to discuss with people, and you have to go through this maze of figuring out what treatment you want to use. But that's something you get to do with your physician, yeah.
And that's, you know, that's part of the ongoing and exciting work that's being done in the area of science and research with arthritis, and like you said, British Columbia is very very much leading the way in that area. How does it sort of look like to try and determine what course of treatment that you would recommend for a patient? Because like you said, there's so many.
Yeah. So the first thing that when I see someone in the office, my first problem is to figure out what is going on. And it's not always 100% clear. Sometimes it's really obvious that they have, say, rheumatoid arthritis because they have the right, you know, the blood work shows that that might be the case and they have the swollen joints in the right way. But sometimes it's a bit of a process just trying to confirm what we're treating. And then we start on treatments, and the goal of the treatment is trying to find something that agrees with the person, that their body likes, and something that controls the arthritis. And it's, I think that's actually the hardest part for patients when they are dealing with an inflammatory arthritis, is probably the first few months when they're going through a process of trying to see what works for them and what agrees with their body. Because you don't know if the treatment's going to be the right one, the first one you try, or maybe it'll be the second one, and so on and so forth. So when I'm picking a treatment, I look at the person in front of me, and, you know, I take into account their age and their other medical conditions. And for example, you know, if it's a young woman who's planning to have a baby in the next year, I would pick a different medication, for example. And so it sort of gets tailored to the individual. And then we also back that up with science, because I don't want to use treatments that don't have any proof to working. I want to use treatments that have been proven to actually help people in big studies. So we combining those two pieces of information is how we sort of tailor the treatment. And I think in the future, I was at a conference earlier this year, and they were talking about what's coming up in rheumatology. And, you know, it probably won't be that long until we can have people in the office, maybe do a few specific blood tests, and we might be able to predict which drug will be exactly the right one for them. So it'll be personalized medicine, but, you know, that's not ready for prime time yet, but it's exciting to know that they're actually working on that.
That is exciting, and I know as someone who's had this condition for so long, I know what massive relief it can be when you finally find the medication cocktail or the mix or whatever that does get that inflammation under control, because having ongoing inflammation in the form of a flare, it's almost all consuming, and it makes everything in your life so difficult. So, you know, one of the things that I talk about is being able to support our overall health and wellness by things like our lifestyle choices, like exercise and movement and things like that. But when you are in the midst of a really challenging flare, it's pretty difficult to do that. So getting inflammation under control is so key.
It's exciting and it's rewarding for me. I love what I do, because seeing people go from those states where they're feeling unwell and exhausted and in pain and inflamed, and then seeing the changes and, you know, getting to hear about whatever they're up to, you know, mm-hmm. going back to work or doing all these exciting projects or having children, and just getting to see that improvement is really rewarding. And I mean, that's on my side of things. I'm imagining that from a patient standpoint, that's also exciting. But, you know, treating arthritis, it is a whole body condition. And so you touch on something important, which is it's not just about medication. It's also about, you know, exercises and, you know, other things that you can do for your health, mental well-being, and just sort of looking at your body as a whole, not just the little pieces of it. I think it's important.
Mm-hmm. What would be the reason that medications or a certain treatment would stop working and you would have to switch it up? Because that happens over time.
It does, yeah. Well, the immune system is, as I was talking about earlier, it's kind of amazing. And sometimes the immune system can adapt to the treatments that you're giving it. And so sometimes the treatments that used to work start to wear off a little bit. And then that's when you want to change your approach and find something else. And so, you know, luckily, once people's arthritis is under control, usually it's under control for quite a long time, but mm-hmm. every so often the medication will stop working or start wearing off, and then we want to approach it just like we did at the beginning, which is to rotate or adjust or mm-hmm. sort of fiddle around with it until we get it back under control. And so luckily with newer and newer options, there's sort of a longer and longer list of different treatments that you can try out if, you know, something else has stopped working or if it doesn't agree with you for some reason.
Exactly. And I know I've experienced that as well when going through different times, and my rheumatologist would tell me, well, you know, there's other things that we can try. There's mm-hmm. other places, there's other ways to go. And there, mm-hmm. and so having those options is really key. One of the things that has been really, really instrumental for my wellness is getting a handle on stress.
Mm-hmm.
So stress is, I talk about it a lot on this program, and I say I can almost chart it. Mm. If things stress, we can't make the stress go away necessarily in our lives, but it's our how we manage it and what our tools are for mm-hmm. that. And if my stress is not well managed and under control, I can pretty much well chart it. Mm-hmm. I'm going to be experiencing more of a of an extreme flare or challenges. And mm-hmm. is that, again, immune system related, that it's just overtaxing?
Yeah, it's possible. You know, it's a hard thing to study. I have a lot of people who they develop arthritis for the first time, and they look back and they say, oh, I was, you know, all these stressors were happening in my life, and maybe that was something that triggered it, or, you know, that triggered a flare. So I hear it enough to believe that it's certainly possible, but it's mm-hmm. a really hard thing mm-hmm. to prove. But we do know that the immune system is affected by stress levels to a degree. Your cortisol level is affected by your stress, and certainly that plays into the whole immune system. So anything's possible, absolutely.
When I was I went through my breast cancer treatment, mm-hmm. and then after that my arthritis was came back really mm-hmm. really quite strong, and mm-hmm. so it took a while, but got that under control. And when once my inflammation was regulated mm-hmm, and mm-hmm, I was being treated correctly from the pharmaceutical end of things, then I was able to start exploring more of the lifestyle, mm-hmm. The lifestyle choices, and doing things like actually putting planned focused exercise into my routines. Mm-hmm. And for myself, I've discovered that even though it might be a little hard starting out initially, mm-hmm. Once I do that, I sort of hobble down the stairs on the way to the gym in the morning, but then when I come home, I'm taking those stairs much, much better.
Yeah.
Pushing the body and doing exercise actually really, really responds on the energy level, mm-hmm. on mobility, on pain.
Mm-hmm.
But again, that key is getting that inflammation under control, because mm-hmm. unchecked inflammation, I mean, that wreaks havoc on our entire body
mm-hmm.
system.
Mm-hmm. And people often ask me if it's all right to exercise when they have arthritis. And we know that absolutely it is all right, with a few exceptions. I mean, mm-hmm. if your joint is really swollen, you don't want to stretch that and make it, you know, sort of stretch out that swelling anymore. But we know that keeping active is good for all types of arthritis. And you can't underestimate that mind-body connection, because, mm-hmm. you know, often if people are feeling depressed, they don't feel like going to exercise, but if you can actually affect your mood by affecting your exercise and vice versa. And so, I mean, they know that it actually can affect how you're feeling in general. And I think we all feel that practically when you don't want to go to do some exercise and you go out and then you feel better after the fact. Mm-hmm. It's amazing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know. It's just it's getting out there and doing it and making those types of things like a real priority, because mm-hmm. it's as important as the medication. It's part mm-hmm. of the whole cycle. I know I finally was able to tackle my sleep issues because when you're not having proper restorative sleep, mm-hmm. then that's a challenging thing along the way, and the emotional side of it, like mm-hmm. you say, if you've got sort of a low mood, and so getting out and doing something with that,
mm-hmm. absolutely.
Would you think that have you noticed that any sort of a difference in the amount of people that are coming to you with diagnoses of arthritis? Is it changing? Are the ages changing? Is the demographic changing?
Well, it's hard to say. A lot of older rheumatologists will say that arthritis that they used to see doesn't really exist anymore. And I don't know if it's because the condition is changing so much or if just that we're getting better at recognizing it. So for example, I think the word has got out to a lot of primary practitioners, be them nurses or physicians, that if you can get someone who has an inflammatory arthritis treated quickly, that they do better. And so if you're able to get treatment earlier, people do better. So I think that we don't see the severity of disease as much as we used to, but at the same time, I mean, I certainly have people who have very severe disease either because they developed it a long time ago, or mm-hmm. perhaps it's just a person where the treatments haven't been as effective for whatever reasons, or maybe there's other medical conditions that play into it. So I think that our understanding of the conditions are improving. For example, if you look at your grandparents' age, people used to talk about rheumatism.
Yes.
You know, yeah. And so everyone comes in and says, oh, my granny had rheumatism. Well, rheumatism isn't really a condition. It's just a way to describe achy joints, which could have been, you know, osteoarthritis or inflammatory arthritis. And just now we have a better understanding of what the different conditions are and how the different treatments work for each of them. So there's conditions called psoriatic arthritis, for example, which is associated with people, some of the people who have psoriasis. Gout is another one that I think people used to just ignore and put up with, mm-hmm. Which, by the way, you shouldn't, because it's incredibly treatable if you get on therapy. And so there's all these different options, and we're just better at treating them nowadays. There's a better understanding.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. What sort of a role does physio play? I know that generally early in a diagnosis, mm-hmm. part of the treatment protocol is to get you hooked up with a physiotherapist. Why would someone want to do that?
Yeah, I think physio is very important because they can do a number of things. They can help teach you how to protect your joints, but also how to keep yourself strong, because, you know, just like anyone knows if they've ever been ill or hospitalized, if you're not using your body, you sort of lose that muscle mm-hmm. strength. And it's always harder to come back from that kind of illness if you don't have the underlying strength. So I think physios are, and especially physios who specialize in arthritis, are amazing, because they can teach you how to do the exercises, how to keep moving, some techniques. For example, someone with back problems, other ways to pick items up, which sounds mm-hmm. really straightforward, but just how to actually accomplish things in a safe way, and also to keep your body strong. And that really can help how your body feels with the arthritis. And so it's sort of an adjunctive therapy that goes along with the medications, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. I know I shared with you before we went on air that mm-hmm. I've been doing some self-guided physio for my knee. Was having some real challenges with it, and I was starting preparing, thinking I was maybe going to be going in for a knee replacement, mm-hmm. and I wanted to be a very good student and start knowing how to do the exercises. And so I started really doing some physio targeted exercises on my knee, and the strengthening mm-hmm. just, and so when you has made such an improvement. So there's, you know, you're putting yourself through not guided, focused and thoughtful, I don't know where I'm trying to look, range of motion,
right?
But you're doing so a little bit of strengthening, a little bit of range of motion, mm-hmm. Pushing a little bit but not too far, mm-hmm. and I've noticed such an amazing difference mm-hmm. in you know, my legs are stronger. They mm-hmm. seem to, my pain is lessened. It's just like, it's really, I knew how to do the exercises from previous mm-hmm. visits to the physiotherapist. Mm-hmm. If someone hasn't recently been to a physiotherapist, I would encourage them to learn how to do it right, because we don't want to do damage.
Absolutely. And I think people forget, and I say this, I say your body's like a machine. You know, every joint that you move has muscles and tendons and bones, and they all mm-hmm. interact. And if it, people are always surprised how much physio can improve them, but, you know, if you can improve the mechanics around the joint, especially, for example, someone with osteoarthritis. I mean, physiotherapy is absolutely key for treatment of osteoarthritis for the hip, for the knee, for the hands. And if you can strengthen the muscles around the knee and have it working better, the surfaces may glide more smoothly, the pain can improve, and you can actually have amazing results from physiotherapy.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. One of the things like physio, massage, mm-hmm. Sort of the complementary health services. It's something that I remember, I think, from the symposium mm-hmm. that was at the university back in June, of sort of recommending that people reach out to their local areas of government and start saying that should be more available and mm-hmm. more supported and covered mm-hmm. for people with conditions like arthritis.
Absolutely. I mean, it would be a dream of mine to have physiotherapy for everyone, because, yeah. you know, that can be a barrier that is trouble for access. There are resources, even if you can't access a physiotherapist directly. You know, the Mary Pack we talked about in Victoria or Vancouver, that is a free mm-hmm. of charge for those kind of treatments. But also, you can access a lot online. So if I have someone sitting in front of me who has a condition and just, you know, they can't make it to a physio, maybe their schedule's too busy or they can't afford it, often we search online and we find some handouts or some videos mm-hmm. because now with technology, I mean, it's not a perfect solution, but there is a lot available if you know where to look and how to find something reputable.
Even just YouTube, right? I mean, you can find out so much. That's where you can get the resources and find out what's possible. Things like physio are sometimes, especially if you're going through like a long period of a flare, I think almost psychologically we'll think, oh, that's not going to help. It's, mm-hmm. you know, I don't want to be, but it really, really does help. Mm-hmm. It's one of the things that can be really, really beneficial.
Yeah. And sometimes it feels overwhelming when you're dealing, and I think this is actually true of almost any medical condition, but mm-hmm. if you have a lot going on and, you know, you're not feeling well and you're exhausted and, you know, sometimes it feels like too much to handle at times. But I always tell people, you know, if you can just chip away at the little parts, you know, take one little goal, and maybe it's physiotherapy or maybe it's exercise, or, you know, there's always something that you can do to work on. And sometimes if you just sort of chip away at the little bits, the whole overwhelming part of it just, you know, gets a little bit better, and that can, you know, snowball into more mm-hmm. benefit from there. So you know it's fighting it a little bit. It's important.
Yeah. And it's you know, it's amazing how the smallest changes can over time make such a huge difference. Mm. And it's just, yeah, tapping into the resources and all of that. As far as sort of the future for arthritis mm-hmm. and research and stuff, what sort of things do you see on the horizon?
Oh, there's so many things happening with research at the moment. So, you know, first of all, the medications are really exciting. So for people who have inflammatory arthritis, it used to be that we didn't have a lot of options, but in the last sort of 15 or 20 years, there's all these new treatments that are coming online, and they're, you know, I remember hearing about them when I was back in university, and, you know, people didn't even think they were going to work, mm-hmm. but they've been so amazing for people who haven't had benefit from the usual treatments that it's sort of opened up a whole new world of options. And what's exciting about that is there's newer medications available all the time. So I'm always having to learn about a new medication or a new option, mm-hmm. and it just means that there's more options for my patients for what to try. And we're really lucky to live in a province where, you know, a lot of those medications, although they're expensive, are covered. As long as you sort of go through the right processes, mm-hmm. the government is amazing. And so we do have these fantastic medications. The other projects that are happening in research is, especially in BC, we're trying to work on access to care, because you know there's a lot of patients who come to visit me from, you know, very far up on the island or even over Powell River and north, and you know it's a huge barrier for them travel wise trying to find a way down, catch the ferries, make it down to my appointment. And with, you know, there isn't a rheumatologist in every community, for example. So if there's ways for them to get care. So for example, I was working on a project where we were treating gout patients, and it was called the Virtual Gout Clinic. And once people had seen a rheumatologist and they'd confirm the diagnosis, they would actually be followed over the telephone with a dietitian and a pharmacist and their doctor to sort of improve their care. And not only does that save money for the healthcare system, but it also saves time and money for those people because they don't have to take time off work. They don't have to travel down. And I think with technology improving, we're going to be able to provide more of that. And in a province as big as British Columbia, with people scattered everywhere, it's only fair if, you know, you live far away and you can access the same care as someone who lives in downtown Vancouver.
Yes. No, that more access to things like that sounds sounds really, really good. And also, you know, when all of those resources can come together from the patient's perspective, you're being looked after and you know, not sort of getting lost in the shuffle with that. That sort of stuff sounds really good.
And I also think that lots of types of medicine, but certainly rheumatology, it's getting more multidisciplinary. We have nurses in our office who are absolutely amazing, and they provide so much information and education, and it just makes the experience better for people. You get that personal relationship with someone over time, with ourselves, but also with our nurses, and it's sort of a team approach. And if you add into that the physios and the occupational therapists, I mean, arthritis is, like we talked about at the beginning, it's a whole body condition. And if you can sort of treat it holistically from all those different angles, then I think that's when people really do well.
And to be into the driver's seat and consider that your rheumatologist, the nurses, your physiotherapist, and yourself, it's all part of the team working together. You know, we need to be actively involved in your own healthcare. It's not something you just, you know, put out your hand and look for the solution. We need to be active participants.
Well, and that's the thing. It's your healthcare. It's not anyone else's. And so, you know, people, I think sometimes they worry that, you know, they're going to go see a doctor and they're going to be forced to do something they don't feel comfortable with. And I'm always telling people, you know, it's not my job to make you do anything you don't feel comfortable with. But really, it's a lot about discussions. It's about talking about your options, the pros and cons of every option, and sort of knowing what your choices are, because ultimately it's your body. That's and you're the one who gets to make the decision.
That's right. Well, this has been fantastic. I mean, and with September being Arthritis Awareness Month, is there anything that you'd kind of like to close on for final thoughts for our listeners?
Well, I just think an understanding of arthritis is so important. People forget how much it affects their lives. People always think about, you know, other important medical conditions, heart attacks and strokes, but arthritis is one of those things that if we can do a better job of treating people, you have less pain, you have more function, and I really think that it makes people feel so much better. So just looking at those resources, you know, if you want to find out perhaps what type of arthritis you have, there's the Symptom Checker on the Arthritis Society is really cool. I was trying it out today myself just to see how it, and it was right whenever I plugged in the different answers. And so, you know, getting an understanding of what you is affecting you and the treatment options, you know, would you benefit mostly from physiotherapy? Are you someone who needs to go see a surgeon for your knee? Or just having an understanding of people who deal with arthritis. And, you know, when you see someone who has deformity of their hands at the checkout or something, understanding that, you know, that's a, it's a tricky thing, but it's actually very common. And, you know, just being understanding of that, I think, is so important.
No, that sounds really good. What I would, I'd like to do is I'd like to sort of connect on an ongoing basis if there are any upcoming resources for the community or anything like that. Let's liaison and make sure I can give, you know, a shout out out on the air and let people know, because, you know, the community here in Nanaimo is thriving, and we all want to be chronically well.
I think that's a wonderful idea. All the talks that come by or the webinars, I think there's a lot of resources.
Fantastic. Well, thank you so much for coming in. That was Dr. Allison Kidd, a local rheumatologist here in Nanaimo, and working with the Arthritis Society of BC.